Hey guys, and thanks for tuning in again. In today's video, I'll show you how I built my first attempt at a small-scale home automation system. It uses an ESP32 dev board that has built-in wireless capability and a Raspberry Pi 0W, also with built-in Wi-Fi. The whole project cost me around $40, which is not that bad considering what it can actually do. But the biggest expense, in my case, were the countless hours spent researching and experimenting. And that's why I wanted to make a video explaining how it all works. This is going to be an overview video, and I'm not going to go into great detail on the code and the setup itself. Instead, I'm going to make a couple of videos after this, maybe even live streams, where I will go into more detail on how the whole system is set up, connected and coded. This video is sponsored by JLC PCB. JLC PCB is a manufacturer of high-quality PCBs and SMT stencils. The two brains of the operation are the ESP32 and Raspberry Pi 0W. When connected via Wi-Fi to the same network, they can communicate using the MQTT protocol. MQTT is a very robust and simple-to-use protocol, perfect for home automation projects. It's based on a publish-subscribe system. There are two main components to the MQTT system. An MQTT broker, which is our middleman that passes all the messages, and the multiple MQTT clients, which communicate with each other through the broker. Messages have two components, the topic and the payload. Topics are used to describe where the message is coming from and what the message contains. Some examples of topics are bedroom/temperature, or bathroom/fan, or living room/TV. The payload is a string of characters that is sent with a topic. It describes what needs to be done exactly for that particular topic. So, if we would, for example, want to turn on the main light in our bedroom, we would send a message with a topic bedroom/main light and the payload on. When I say send, we are actually publishing to a topic from a device. That device that is publishing is only concerned with connecting to the broker and publishing the message, nothing else. The other device that will actually turn on the light needs to subscribe to a topic. That device is also only concerned with connecting to the broker and listening to messages that it is subscribed to. If it hears a message from a topic that it is subscribed to, it does the necessary actions that are pre-programmed for that topic and that message. In our case, it would turn on the relay that was connected to the device that turns on the light. Now that you have a basic understanding of the MQTT protocol, let's continue with our system. The ESP32 board has several components and sensors connected to it. The HTU21D temperature and humidity sensor, which reads the ambient temperature and humidity in the room. An infrared transmitter LED, which can control devices such as a LED strip, a TV or a sound system if it's in range of all of them. A 8-channel relay board, which can connect to low power, mains power devices such as fans, lights and other devices you wish to control wirelessly. And a 1838 infrared receiver module, which can be used to program our system with codes from different remotes and may also be used to trigger some events when an infrared signal is received. The Raspberry Pi is going to be used as our server for this home automation project. It is running the DietPi lightweight operating system, which is based on Debian Linux. It also has Mosquito installed, the MQTT broker that the ESP32 is going to connect to. The SQLite database for storing our temperature and humidity data, as well as other things we might want to store in the future. And finally, Node-RED, a truly versatile piece of software, which is used not only as an MQTT and SQL client, but as a rule and virtual wiring tool that we will use to set up how everything is going to work together. It also has an add-on for a web-based UI that you can completely customize and which we are going to use to communicate with our home automation system. Let me quickly explain how the system works. The ESP32 board takes the temperature and humidity from the sensor every 5 seconds. It then broadcasts a message with those values to the MQTT broker. Node-RED listens to that topic and displays the values on the gauges in the UI. Also, every 87 seconds, it saves the data with the current timestamp and the temperature and humidity values to the database. The data is displayed in the chart where you can select which day you wish to show the historical data from. If you open the control UI on Node-RED, you can send infrared controls to multiple devices. When a button is pressed in the UI, Node-RED publishes to a topic corresponding to the device the button was clicked, with the message containing the actual code that needs to be sent over infrared. The ESP32 subscribes to the same topic, takes the message and sends it through the infrared diode controlling the device we want. The 8-channel relay system works the same way. You select the device that you want to turn on or off, Node-RED publishes to the topic of that particular device, the ESP32 subscribes to that topic, parses the message, whether you wish to turn it on or off, and sets the data pin connected to the relay to either high or low based on that message. I'll run you through all the necessary steps you need to do to get both the Raspberry Pi and the ESP32 set up. First, download the Raspberry Pi image that I compiled with all programs and services pre-installed. You will also need Etcher, an image flashing tool, and a microSD card with minimum 8GB storage, and of course a card reader. Once you've installed Etcher, open it and select the Raspberry Pi image and click on Flash. Once that is done, open the contents of the SD card and edit the diet.py text document located on the root directory. Here, you can set your wireless router's network name and password, and also set a static IP address so that you always know where your Raspberry Pi is located. You can tinker around with other settings, but I found that mostly leaving everything by default works for me. Insert your SD card to the Raspberry Pi and let it boot up. Once it has, you should have all the necessary components pre-installed already. Now let's move on to the ESP32. We will use the Arduino IDE for uploading the sketch. If you don't have it installed yet, the download link is in the description below. Before you can upload the sketch, you first need to install the necessary board and all the libraries. You have the latest install instructions on the Arduino ESP32 GitHub repository. Once you have installed the board, go to my GitHub repository and download all the files from there. There is a folder called Libraries. You need to copy all these folders to your Arduino Libraries folder. There is a README file there with instructions on how to install Arduino libraries. Open the Arduino sketch you downloaded and open the auth.h tab. Here, enter your Wi-Fi credentials as well as the Raspberry Pi IP address. Select your ESP32 board type and press Upload. If for some reason your upload doesn't go through, before uploading, hold down the boot button on the ESP32 and then press Upload. If you set up everything correctly and go to your Raspberry Pi's Node-RED UI, you should start seeing the temperature and humidity values change every couple of seconds. When I was testing out the project, I put all the necessary components on the breadboard and connected them to my ESP32. You can check out my schematic for a more detailed view on how everything is connected. After I had my proof of concept working on the breadboard, it was time to create a custom PCB for this project. I used the EasyEDA online software to set up my schematic that I would later use as a base for my PCB. I'll show you how I got my PCBs professionally printed by jlcpcb.com, who are the sponsors of this video. First, go to jlcpcb.com and click on the Quote Now button on the right side. Next, upload the Gerber files of your project. Below, you will see how your finished PCBs will look like. You can tweak the settings below to match your personal needs. When you're happy with the results, you may choose the shipping method and see the shipping estimate to your country instantly. Next, click on the Save to Cart button. If you don't already have an account with JLCPCB, you can register here and once done, log in with your new credentials. Once logged in, click on the Checkout Securely button on the right-hand side. Fill out your shipping information, choose a shipping method, payment method, and click Continue.
Once your payment has been processed, you can expect your PCBs to arrive very soon. After waiting for about a week, my new PCBs have finally arrived. As always, I was very happy with the end results, and would like to thank JLC PCB once again for making this video possible.
Next step was to solder the ESP32 to the board. I used pin headers, so I wouldn't have to solder my ESP32 to the board directly. That way, I could swap it out easily if it broke or I needed it for a different project. For most of the other components, I wanted to use pin headers as well, with DuPont wires. But on my original PCB design, I managed to add a smaller footprint pit header holes, which wouldn't fit with my DuPont wires. So I had to manually solder each wire in place to the board. Fortunately, if you want to print this PCB, you won't have this problem, as I fixed all the issues I had on my first prototype board. I added some heat shrink tubing to the wires of the infrared LED and the infrared receiver. When all the soldering was done, I decided to enclose the Raspberry Pi and the module inside the plastic casing. I drilled holes for the LED, infrared receiver, sensors, and the cables that would connect to the relay board. The handheld Dremel and drill really aren't made for this kind of precision work, but I made it work somehow. But when I finally got everything hooked up, glued, and connected, the end result was really worth it. With this small box, I could control my TV, LED strip, sound system, and lights. It would also monitor the inside humidity and temperature, as well as get real-time data from an external API for the outside humidity and temperature, and display them nicely in a graph. I even save all these values to a local database and display those values in a chart based on the date that I choose. A lot of effort and time went into making this project, and I really, really hope that you enjoyed watching it. If you liked the video and would like to see future videos like this, consider subscribing. It would really mean a lot to me. I hope you learned something, and I'll catch you in the next one. Cheers!